Hello and good evening to you all. This is Grandmaster Aucher Malinsky, jam in residence at St. Louis Chess Club, and today my Grandmaster choice. It's the second week that I'm here, so I already started last week with this subject, and I chose to focus my attention on young players who distinguished themselves in the year 2022, particularly at the Chess Olympiad, which took place in Chennai, India, and had a very surprising outcome. So last week we talked about the player who was the motor of India 2 team, a very young squad that competed and came very close to winning this event, which would be very surprising, of course, the way it turned out that they lost to Uzbekistan in a critical match, which is also a very young team and also a very surprising winner. So the story now continues with the leader of Uzbeki team, the 18-year-old Nazarbek Abdusatorov. Again, the same question. How come that these young players, how come they become so good at such a young age? And here again, I have to give some credit to the Chess Federation or the sponsors. They provided them with coaching. So I talked about Gukesh and Pragananta, how they got help from Kramnik and Gelfand at training camps. That was very important. And with the Uzbek team, well, obviously, the leading player in Uzbekistan for many years was Rustam Kasimjanov. Although he lived and still lives in Germany most of the time, but he keeps his ties with his home country, and he was there coaching these guys. And he also provided coaching help by arranging visits of some grandmasters to Uzbekistan. I recall how my friend from Turkey, Grandmaster Suat Atavik, went there for training camp. And these guys, the entire lineup of the Uzbek Olympic team was there, and it was 3 years ago. They were all very young then, 15, 14, 13 years old. But this is how it worked. And I want to point out one more thing. It's very important for young players to train together as a unit, because they help each other. They compete with each other, that's true, but they also kind of pull together as a team. And that particularly is important considering that they are going to be the team, the national team, come the next Olympiad, whatnot. Well, obviously, it's easier to criticize, but I would say this in my experience coaching in the United States. I never had this feeling coming from my students. They had ambitions, well, they wanted to reach the heights, but they treated their peers as just competition. Wanted to beat them. Rarely I saw good, friendly relationship between these boys. And that, honestly, it surprised me first, and then I just thought, maybe that's because the country is so big, you know, and separated by distances, and they only meet each other at some tournaments every once in a while. Maybe that's why. Or maybe, just maybe, at some moment, the USCF kind of dropped the ball. They had a chance to organize some training camps. I'm sure they could make this possible, but they didn't. So anyway, it's just my wish, you know, that we learn from the example of India and Uzbekistan and Azerbaijan and other countries that certainly, don't have the resources that we have here, but they managed to get their scholastic programs going, and ultimately translated in a crop of young players that took over. So about Abdusatorov, obviously, I was familiar with the name because he's 18 years old. He already became known for 2 or 3 years. I couldn't quite, you know, like figure out what kind of chess he plays. I noticed that he well, I mean, there are openings that the kind of were always popular in his home country, like the King's Indian defense with black. And they have some young players on the team that play the King's Indian. Not to say that that's a bad choice or bad opening, but Abdusatorov somehow was able to incorporate different openings into his opening repertoire, maybe quicker than others. I think it helped him to mature a little faster than his peers. Of his style, no, I guess the games would tell better than I can put it in words. No, reading comments here. Fischer said chess can be brutal. Well, yeah. That's right. No, okay. Keep on talking, guys. I'm not missing anything. In the meantime, let's go. So, all the games are going to be from the Olympiad, which took place in the summer. This is an early round, and the team from Faroe Islands, it's not supposed to be very strong, but they have this decent player on board one, Ziska. You can see that he's rated 25-49. So obviously that, nobody's guaranteed to beat a 25-49 guy, particularly with the black pieces. Let's see how Abdusatorov. Okay, hang on. Yeah. So, bishop b5. Well, I can only guess what's in Noderbeck's repertoire against normal d4 open Sicilians. Could possibly be the Sveshnikov. The Sveshnikov is the line that appeals to young players because it's very streamlined. And the existing theory is kind of easy to absorb, and it's particularly useful when you play against high-rated players because they feel like they have to enter theoretical lines, and they're unhappy because they want the young player to be on their own, but no, they just play theoretical moves. We might say, obviously, the efforts of Carlsen lately, they promoted the Sveshnikov variation again. Carlsen made the switch before the Caruana match. I think it was very useful for him. Rejuvenated his career at that moment when Magnus was in a slump. But so it's a great opening line. So I think Abdusatorov plays it, but here we have the Ras Salima, and he reacts this way. Carlsen prefers g6. All right. This is all known, and in the past I thought the main move here was d5. With the idea of capturing on d5 with the queen. Because the white pawn on c3 takes away the square from the knight. But I suppose that white can play this move and try to open up the position a little bit, playing in the spirit of the Alpine Sicilian, the c3 Sicilian. Now that knight on e7, on the one hand, it reinforces c6, but then it blocks the bishop, the f8 bishop. So there is some danger for black to fall behind in development. So I suppose that's why a different plan that starts with b5 came to replace the old move d5. Now the question is, like, black did all these things on the queen side, but what are they going to do against white's main plan, which is to put the pawn on d4. So they play this move. So, first thing we notice, if white does this, obviously they want to take back with the pawn, right? To have the center and open the c3 square for the knight. But then black immediately plays this move. So they're on the bishop, and the bishop cannot retreat because the pawn on the four is unprotected. It's not the kind of trade that white wants. Now clearly, the strong center, two pawns side by side, one of the advantages is that you can move the e-pawn forward and grab space and translate it into an attack on the king. But for that, your light square bishop will be a very important piece. And if it's gone, well, it's much harder. No, besides, in general, trades help black because if he is... It's going to be modest with his central pawns. Oh, that's going to be a little short of space. So it trades that piece, opens the c5, and the bishop is open on b7. So white plays this move, protecting the pawn on e4, overprotecting it. But now this, and interestingly enough, d4 is met by the same knight before idea, to be followed by this shot. I think I saw this idea for the first time. I'm not sure if this was the exact position, but very similar, also in some kind of a anti-Sicilian bishop b5 in the games of Joel Benjamin. No, now it's a different bishop that black gets, but obviously they win the exchange back, so there's no material losses. And again, no, it helps black a lot. So seeing this, Ziska plays a4. No, the logical move, obviously, to soften the queen side a bit and hoping that the black pawn will go to b4. Because that way the square would be occupied and white can push the d pawn forward without worrying about the lines that we just covered. Comes knight g6. Now knight a3. No, the position is known, but not that well explored. I mean, I found some games, and some of them were played by decent players, but nothing that indicated any kind of serious work on this position, like that somebody prepared for a world championship match or, you know, candidates tournament. So games are rather random. So it is hard to tell what the best option is. I mean, I looked at this. Maybe do it this way to avoid this tactical idea, trade a pair of knights, but white really doesn't want that. Again, black's got the c file to operate on, and the control of the a file is probably not super important because white's rook invasion can be repelled by the simple move queen b6. In the meantime, the pawn on b5, no, doesn't have to go forward yet, but if the white knight comes out to c3, then it's going to be disturbed by this pawn. So I understand why white don't find this attractive. Oh, there is one more thing I want to mention, that the black knight on g6. I mean, normally you would try to use your h pawn to harass that knight. Maybe the pawn could even go all the way to h6 to weaken the dark squares. But here it's not supported by the knight on f3. Much harder to do. So anyway, that's why it goes here. Now the position is going to look a little different. But the next move is remarkable. It goes to show that Abdusatorov understands that he needs to clear out the diagonal for the bishop and the c-file for the rook as well. So he puts his knight on the edge of the board and recaptures with the queen. All in the name of trading a pair of knights. Now Ziska goes forward, which is a good move because, white's not losing a pawn. Here after this move, either you lose a queen, a couple of moves here, I suppose. Yeah, that's the Korean. Or you go this way, gonna lose the bishop. So it seems like white has accomplished his goals, and now what's he thinking to do next? Oh, possibly that idea h4, h5. Else, move one of the central pawns forward, that's also possible. But I thought, I mean, I like this move a lot that Abdusatorov played. It's just it's a difficult move to play. In the sense that we release the tension in the center, seemingly giving white free hand to operate on the king side. It's hard to play this move, but it has some fine points. Among them, suddenly the black queen is not so poorly placed. Even if the attack on c3 doesn't really materialize. I mean, the queen can swing over to h5. That could be very useful, particularly in reply to white's move h4. Obviously, presence of the black queen will change the picture on the queen side. And there's something else. So white played this move, bishop e3. Okay, and again, well played by Ziska, he doesn't have to worry about the c3 pawn. And the reply was b3. Now, looking at the games of these young players, I already talked about this when we talked about Gokesh. I mean, they have a very strong foundation in their game, this positional understanding. They very well versed in various pawn structures coming out of the opening, and they usually they hit on the right plan, which is remarkable because they used to be like the top players of generations before them. They had much narrower opening repertoire because they needed to learn the resulting middle game positions and play them well. And yet, you know, would take them, I don't know, 15, 20 years of practice. Now it's just so much faster. I guess the computers help out and all that. But having said that, obviously the play is not perfect, right? Well, sometimes the execution, can be improved, but which is only... It's only logical, right? I mean, they're young players, they will get better. Like in this case, I think that while b3 is a good idea, I think black could have improved on that somewhat by first playing the bishop to e7, which is obviously useful developing moves, and just keep this b3 idea on hold for maybe just one move. Because if white does the same thing that they did in the game, knight to d2, then the c3 pawn can be taken, because nothing hits the queen. The queen will escape. So possibly that would be some refinement of the move order, but he played this. So now we have this new issue which was there, and obviously Abdusatorov was aware of that. It's keeping the white a1 rook out of play. Okay then, knight d2, good move. So white switches to c4 pawn, the queen has to come back. And now the stage is set for white to grab some key squares on the king side with his queen. Well, by the way, the move d5, which would kind of complete black's build up the pawn structure, pawn chain, I think that would be a mistake, because leading to this French structure is probably not in black's best interest, because now white enjoys great stability in the center, and they can bring it all order of forces, the king said, against the black king. So no d5. Let's give a question mark on the move d5. Now, Abdusatorov designed a different plan of dealing with this thing. Obviously, he was expecting white to play like e5 to open up the bishop and clear out the e4 square for the knight to come through. And he found a way of dealing with that. It's a very modest looking move, f6. But the point of this move is to answer this with f5 without giving white a chance to do the ampersand on f6, which white obviously would have done otherwise, right? Now I get a question, why these young players got stuck around at 27-25 rating? Stuck around for how long exactly? Both Gokesh and Abdusatorov just broke into 2700 rating after the Olympiad, which was, when? 3 months ago. I mean, there are hardly any tournaments. There wasn't enough time. I don't think we can say that they got stuck. Yes, some. We had some cases when a promising young player, it happened to a couple of Russian guys. You might mention Dubov and Fedoseyev and Artemyev. But I think there is this, also the political situation and all that, it's just... Then again, I don't know. Every player situation is different. So, so coming back to the position, that would be very important improvement for black, to have that pawn on f5, because now they take control of the e4 square and they can make this effective battery with the queen supported by the bishop all the way to g2. The pawn on f5, the e4 square obviously important, and it also blocks this bishop from b1. I'm looking at this. How is white going to get that rook into play from a1? They need to move the bishop somewhere, but absolutely no squares on the diagonal. They're all taken away. So Ziska understood this. Give him credit, and he did not play e5. Instead, he tried this move, which actually has a very fine point of preparing the move rook a4. Sneaky to hit the c4 pawn, and finally force black to play d5. If this happens, in this situation with the pawn on f6, obviously the simplest thing white can do is to take and win the pawn on g6. Which is not so bad, right? So d5 is never going to be good for black. So he needs to do something else instead against rook a4. So he played that move. He win there. Now pinning the e4 pawn. All right. Ziska goes forward. Actually, looking at this position, I totally expected black to play f5, because it's their plan, right? Put the pawn on f5. Maybe black doesn't yet want to take on e4 because of bishop takes e4. But on the other hand, how can white make e takes f5 a threat if they have to deal with this checkmate on g2? It's very unlikely. Rook e2. Несерлісо. Yeah, this is interesting. No, I can suggest one defensive move, but nobody would want to play it. To play like knight h8, and if white takes on f5 twice, there would lose a piece to the move g6. But ideally, of course, I didn't want to do this. Maybe there is something else. I mean, it's entirely possible that black can play this pawn sacrifice, because when this happens, I was thinking, no, I'm not so sure. Again, I'm kind of experimenting here. So I was thinking of the sacrifice followed by this, but I can see now that it doesn't work because g2 has sufficient support. Yeah, if I cannot sack like this, then the bishop will return to e4. Yeah, I'm not sure. This bishop e4. Oh, okay, this is probably. B the bishop could also have gone back to b1. So the knight is pinned on g6. So, yeah, maybe rook e2 would be the best move, yeah. I'm not sure, well, if that was the reason why Abdusatorov didn't play f5. I thought maybe he was scared of d5. Because if they take, then it's pretty bad. Because on this, there's the in-between move. Bishop there, and the black knight is hanging on g6, followed by checkmate threat. So there's just no time to grab white bishops. I mean, normally you would play d5 and two bishops under attack and so on and so forth, but not the case here. You're gonna get mated on h7. But I was surprised to discover this move, which kind of looked strange. But f4 comes under attack, and most importantly, if white. If white takes and takes, then this is a double attack, and the bishop is pinned. So there is no bishop e4, the key move. The queen is unprotected. And so that queen d6. No, okay, anyway, he didn't play it. He played bishop d6. And I thought after this, Ziska played a good move and I liked white's position. I think that was critical whose pawn gets to f5. But again, you know, I'm looking at these games and I understand that this unusual position, and I think both players handled it reasonably well coming to this. Does losing to kids hurt my pride? I stopped losing to kids because I stopped playing. I'm immune to this because no, it just never happens to me anymore. Anyway, here, rook f2 e8. Well, it's often this like dilemma which rook to play, and this it feels like, you know, that black should put a rook on the e-file. It probably could have done this because I don't see how white wins the pawn on c4. I mean, it's attacked, but it's protected for now. But I think Abdusatorov won this game because he moved the rook away from the f-file. Now, see about this. So he played this. Ziska played well again here. Now black sets this up, and Why thought it's no big deal, it's just a check. Just went forward. Well, fact is, if he played knight f1, I think I like it more than knight f3. I don't really know why. But e4 is protected. White's plan remains the same, h5. No, possibly h6, I don't know. Maybe bishop h6 could be useful. Well, the only blemish, of course, is that rook, which still sits there on a1. But maybe in maybe some kind of e5 break at some moment. I don't know. I like White's position. I think the center is quite good. But after this, now you'll see why. I'm sure Ziska would have never played it if the black rook was on f8. Because he would be looking at f5 on every move. But he didn't think that f5 would ever happen. Because the black rook left the f-file. And that's exactly what Abdusatorov played. And no, the effect of this move is devastating. And as a matter of fact, I couldn't find any defense for white. Important lines. Start with taken. No, queen takes I rejected, right? Queen h2 check followed by rook f8. That's not good. It was the queen. So I, sorry. Take with the pawn. Now this. This one allows black to throw in the bishop. With the threat of queen h1 check to win the rook. With check and well, mate. Because bishop g1 you don't cover because of rook takes a one mate. Obviously white suffers greatly from rooks being disconnected. So he, well, so we play king f2 as the main move. And now comes this shot. No, threatening discover check, like bishop h3, so we take. Now check, there, trade, capture. No, the bishop on e3 is under attack, so white may try this. It's some sort of a defense and attack, but it just doesn't work. Even if white escapes with this, rook e2 check is probably good enough, but maybe this is even better. Black's ahead material, exchange and a pawn. Importantly, he maintains this pawn on b3, that's winning pawn in the endgame, right? If he gets to drop the rook on the second and get the b2 pawn, it's going to be very easy. So Ziska played queen to h3, and then after this, so he was hoping to trade on f4 and recapture on e4, which would, you know, opposite cover bishops and reasonable position, but this shot just nailed it. Now deflection. Check. Followed by rook f8. Okay. There's no remedy for that, so white resigned. Now f5. Mm. Again, you know, so well, you can say that why is that a great game if after knight f1 white was better? No, so, so what? First of all, white played a lot of good moves, and I give credit to Abdusatorov for conducting interesting game with this unusual pawn structure and complicating matters and ultimately benefiting from white's oversight, missed f5. No, I want to talk about like this. It's kind of like this great school. You could tell, you know, that Abdusatorov, like other young players, he studied classical examples, and it's not only the opening and typical end games, it's middle game patterns that really there. Look how he finished the game against an experienced player from Slovenia. Now, white has a lot of space, but no, he has the dark square bishop, so maybe some chance for black to organize a blockade. And it seemed like white's play should be on the queen side, but that's where the black pieces are. So Abdusatorov catches this moment when black was in the midst of repositioning his pieces and strikes surprisingly in the center. But it's a total classic, right? To open up the bishop, and now the rook lived on the third rank. This. In order to save the pawn on g7, well, black had to play the only move. Now comes this. So that's the e8 rook that comes to protect the pawn, because the c7 rook protects g7. Now this. I mean, the bishop obviously is a great piece, and no, it's kind of hard to wrap your mind around the idea of trading it for that knight on b8, but no, that's the first line that helps white to break through and capture the pawn on e6. Unless black played that, which I think would be a better idea. Now, of course, if the rook moves away, then it's capture on b8 followed by capture on e6, essentially leading to the game continuation. But maybe black should sacrifice the exchange. I even looked at this move. There, I don't know, queen takes, rook takes. I mean, it's two pawns. No. I still think white is better. They attack with b5. But anyway, no. Well, probably give black better fighting chance. So he played rook to f7, and now white pretty much gonna wrap up this game. Particularly after this move. No, okay, maybe f4, but he would answer it with the same move. Pretty, right? Keeping the black queen out of play. Don't blunder. Don't take on f4. I think there's going to be queen b1 check, and then I don't know. The white king would have to find some escape from checks, and that's certainly unnecessary. Better is rook to 6, keeping all the threats. No, he could have played f4 here, but I don't think it would change a whole lot. He played king h8, and now another very pretty move. Completely boxing in black's pieces. It's just impossible to come up with anything else but this move. But white's happy to trade. Take that pawn. Hit the pawn on b7. And after g6, I think g5 would lead to the same thing. Check, and there. So the time control was made, and if there was a time control, I don't remember it at that tournament, move 40. But anyway, black resigned because they probably looked at this line. The queen is so bad, it has to come out. But now white will win the pawn endgame because of the break. The black king is just too far away, so it runs, but at the cost. Now white will win. So, pretty emphatic finish with this f5. Pretty game. But now to the big one. Just like with Gukesh, well, people were watching games and noticing these young players winning a lot of games, but they said, oh, but the real test will come when they get to play top players. And the top players, no, the US team obviously is loaded with highest rated players, and Fabiano Caruana on board one. So just like last week when we last game was the game between Caruana and Gukesh. It's gonna be Caruana again with white against Abdusatorov. Bishop f4. I think when Fabi was Abdusatorov's age, he would never play the London. I mean, he studied like all the topical lines and wanted to become this expert in all topical openings, and he did actually. But then, I think it's not just the influence of his peers, obviously, no, Carlsen and others. I think also that just because of so many rapid and blitz games that no, you just can't be mentally prepared for those heavy duty battles and complicated positions. And every once in a while you want to play something strategically simpler, and this, I'm not sure it fits Fabiano's style. I think this game is a prime example of that. Because he still wants it all. Well, a player who is successful with the London or Trampovsky or other kind of offbeat lines, you know, they have to be more on the practical side. You know, not necessarily trying to win the game out of the opening. But that's just my opinion, and well, I don't know if anybody cares. So I play this. Abdusatorov didn't want to put his pawn on e6, which is leads to more standard structures where I get to play knight e5. So he plays this instead and puts his bishop out. Now white can no longer count on success if they just play c3 and knight e5, because they don't get to put the bishop on d3. Don't really have an attack on the king side. And if we look at this structure, like this exchange variation in the Caracan, e takes d5, then you probably recall that white always follows it immediately with the move bishop d3, like Fischer did in the Cara on move 4. So yeah, the bishop is on f5. So that's logical for white to try to look for something. And that has to be done quicker before black completes the development of the king side. So this move, now c4. So this had been played before. But still not that well researched. So the move that I saw, I think there was a game, maybe in the US Championship. I'm trying to recall who the players were. Unable to recall. It was something like this. So white stepped back with the bishop to keep the castle. No, okay, there is a little bit of something, right? If it wasn't for this move queen before, if black had already castled, then, I mean, white wouldn't have anything. Now, no, they do something. I know what black is going to play. If they play rook d8 to cover the d6 square, then white probably can switch with knight e5. I'm not sure which knight. put pressure against the six. Rook c1 is in the cards. Okay, there is something. Abdusatorov played this move. No, I think what bishop d3 was played in the US Championship. And this was played. And that game, I think, went kind of this way. Now again, white had to trade some pieces, but they got something going, just a little bit, some kind of pressure on the c file, trying to win the pawn on c6. I'm not sure if it's so dangerous for black. Well, the b2 pawn then will be a backward pawn, and black can have some pressure on the b file, and of course the isolated pawn on d4. Besides, black may try to hold it. Just take on c6 with the pawn. Well, mutual weaknesses, d4 versus c6. I'm not sure white has anything here. Now, Fabi plays this move, queen f3. Now, it's hard to tell because with Caruana, he likes to play the opening very fast because he has the reputation to uphold, right? That he's a number one theoretician, so he catches people in opening preparation. Now comments. Roman Ginger said that the London system is quite weak. No surprise. Roman is. It's kind of old school. Back then, when Roman was active player, only club players played London. I'd say the first player in my memory that started playing played the London and was Gata Kamsky. But even so, people thought, no, he's just young and he will abandon it eventually. But no, he didn't. Really, completely abandon it, but of course Gata played main lines too later. I'm not sure, I don't want to criticize the opening that can be played tomorrow. We can have some kind of a Carlson thing with five games going on and all five could be the London. So why should I be saying anything? Let people play what they want. Now, I don't know if lessons from Eric Rosen, I'm sure they're very useful. So, queen to f3. So reputation to uphold in the sense that the opponents should always think, okay, I'm doomed because it's Fabi, so everything's analyzed. The young players, when they break through and they have to deal with older guys, well, let's go back, 12 years or so. When did Fabi, maybe 10 or 12 years. There was still Kramnik there, Anand, he had to play these guys. That was very useful. Obviously, they felt nervous playing against this younger guy, but now the script has been flipped, right? He's playing the guys that are 10 years younger than him. And they're not going to be intimidated by this. It's basically didn't impress Abdusatorov here. I don't like this move, queen f3. And black didn't have to do anything special. So he did this. Now the capture on c4, it's going to be that bishop b4 check. And you would have to take with the king, possibly on d2, so that's not good. So he took this way, but now black has time to play a6. Same thing, but feels like black gained time. Because there's no queen before, the bishop is hanging. So he did this, and now the knight is under attack, and who would want this position after 18 moves with the white pieces? You get the isolated pawn and you traded all the, almost all the minor pieces. So now white has to defend. No, in itself, well, it doesn't mean that white's gonna lose.
I mean, but where did he go wrong?
Who? Caruana? Queen f3? Queen f3, clearly question mark. That move, absolutely, had nothing to do with anything. You have to take on c4. And it was played before, and I think he knew it. I don't know what was with queen f3.
Could queen f3 have been prepared?
How do I know? It was played quickly, but again, you know, I'm saying maybe it was a bluff. I mean, I don't know. He likes to bluff people. So play, maybe if you're not sure or got something confused, but you still play that move fast, not to show like the, no, weakness or whatever. But I mean. No, in this case it didn't work. Well, so coming back to this position, there is a lot of stuff that still happened in this game. I find the move knight f4 remarkable because it's like you're a young player, right? You got this lucky opening against Caruana himself. Well, wouldn't you want to like keep control like this and make sure that there's no d5? You most likely you're not going to win the game, but no, you're doing no sort of a proper thing. Instead, the young player from Uzbekistan abandons the d5 square. His plan is to attack the d4 pawn. And he did attack it. No, not threatening to take it yet, but another thing is that the move knight e4, which he played a few moves ago, right, pushed the white queen away from d2, so white is no longer able to intercept the c file, which becomes rather critical. It's the only open file. But rook c1 surely is a bad move to give two rooks for the queen in this situation. No, not to mention the back rank horror immediately. So Fabi plays this, which is thematic and a good move. So white needs to keep their pieces active and partying with the pawn is no reasonable price to pay for it. So got knight f5, now this. I don't particularly like the next move. I think that again, this time management followed the same pattern lately in Caruana's games. So once his preparation is over, he starts spending chunks and chunks of time, literally like 20 minutes on every move almost. And he catches up and, no, I think it has something to do with rather excessive speed of his play when he plays his prepared moves. I don't think it's the right idea at all. Well, I mean, even if you know the variation, if you played it many times before, a little bit of thinking, maybe a minute or two, you know, will keep your chess engine warming up. And if you answer immediately and jump and start pacing the stage, you know, then, I mean, you're not in working condition. So sooner or later, you would have to make your head work, and that's. But that's just my opinion as a coach. But anyway, nobody has to listen to me. Queen h4. I don't like this move because queen f4 was better. Still trying to play rook c1. I think rook c1 is needed. Like you trade one pair of rooks, and maybe just go h4. I mean, you cannot take the pawn, you walk under the spin, it's gonna be a disaster. You'll never come out of the spin alive. Well, that is clear, but forget about capturing the pawn. The pawn cannot move forward. H4 to give your king a flight square, just in case. that loft and no, I think it's a reasonable position, but he needed to do this. After this, he didn't get that because he couldn't play rook to c1. It's hard to find a constructive idea here for white. So he went back, and now, white can only hope to survive here. Actually, for a while it was okay. Because this, I'm not sure it really helped black, because it doesn't really have a true queenside majority, because his b7 pawn and c4 pawn are disconnected. No, if he gets to take on a5 and make the proper pawn chain, but it's hard to do, because in such positions, king safety is priority. Like, I thought maybe this move queen d4, and take on a5, you give up c4, it's probably not good. I'm not sure how black can really improve his position. But Fabi, who was in time trouble, played h5, which is the kind of move that we play automatically in blitz, because now we try to generate chances, but came this capture. Black even gained some room for the king. I don't know, it's always hard to tell in these positions with on the one hand it's a lot of firepower, queen and rook on both sides. So you want to keep the king covered, but then maybe it's not enough to always bother the king when it's in the open, because you only have two pieces. And if they don't have squares to attack the king. So I'm not sure. He played rook e4 here. I think both players had a shortage of time. Maybe it's not the best that they did some repetition. But Abdusatorov continues to play for a win. Now, this is critical. There were only two moves before time control. Fabi missed a tactic for himself that would probably save the game for him. He played the rather obvious move, king h2, to step away from rook e1 check. Because white needs to keep pieces on the board. But it would be better accomplished if he found this. Because now, surprisingly, rook e1, it's king h2. It's mate on f6. Now, black may lose the game playing like this. Because white then can throw the rook on the 7th rank, covering the d6 square, the only check to his king. If queen is 7 back, then there is this tactic. Again, white will probably win. And if they take the pawn, which is a reasonable move, now the white rook cannot attack because of queen c1, queen f4. That kind of pattern. But is there any way to avoid perpetual check? I'm not sure. Maybe not. Fabi missed that. Sorry. Unfortunately, he played king to h2. Now after this. No, that's why black needed that extra h pawn. Now it's big trouble. Big trouble. Now, of the possible improvements that I'm sure that are coming. No, what would Carlsen do in this position? No, for sure he would take the rook endgame with extra pawn. Just to eliminate all the uncertainty, all the, that white has to, no other choice. No, okay, he would do this. I mean, I'm not sure white can make a draw here. Well, they will try, but it's extra pawn. Well, the young player, I think he pushed it a little too far with this move. Still, it opens up the king, and Caruana found a very good response. He played queen c8, that was a great move. But the follow-up was not found, rook d7. Amazingly, that but the white king is covered just for one moment. It's all, that's all that white needs to get the play going. On queen a8 now, they take on b7. So this, on queen f6, they probably take on b7 this way. There are threats, rook b6, right? So that's just enough for white to escape. Fabi took on f5. Maybe he played this move because he thought that's the only move to look at, because no, I must take a pawn. Now, as I said, you know, it's hard to tell which king is worse off, but somehow white only had one check from f4, which is also answered by check, and now there's a bad rook endgame. This check. Well, king f4 simply loses because white allows the opponent to get two connected passed pawns. He had to go here to h4 because now, in case of rook takes a5, there are two checks, winning the pawn on b7, which gives better drawing chances. There won't be any connected passed pawns. Most likely, black should play rook to b5 and just take their time improving. Well, I'm sure it's a win for black. White's passive, and sooner or later. It was sooner. I'll play the rest of the moves. Now the king goes to h5, that's essential. And okay, that's your classic, right? Connected passed pawns. No, what white did was as good or as bad as anything else, but it was nowhere near. Too much. White resigned. So, in an interesting coincidence, that both these young players, who I took notice of, and I'm sure everyone else did, well, they defeated Fabiano Caruana with the black pieces. Granted, the US team underperformed because of, no, they say bad form of players, but no, I don't know how to explain this. Indeed, they were so much higher rated, and they were pretty much out of contention for even for medals. One possible explanation, if all the well, great conditions and great opportunities to play and make a lot of money, they play each other possibly too much. No, there's a bit of a, I don't know, exclusive club here for the players, and I'm sure they're great, but well, they need to interact with the larger pool of players in order to keep their game sharp. I think that's not happening. The only player, I think, who keeps their level, surprisingly, is Nakamura of the American players. No, because, you know, how Hikaru is. He says, what do you want from a poor streamer? You know, just playing some moves, leave me alone. He has the right attitude, but the other guys, they don't have it. And I think their game, stagnated, put it this way. All right, but then again, there'll be more tournaments, and fortunes always change. All right, so let's round this up. Now I'm thinking who is my next hero is going to be. Possibly I would have to... No, it's going to be a young player for sure, but give me time, you know. I'll talk to you about this next week again, and happy Thanksgiving if you're celebrating it. Take care.